On the third floor of the physics department at Otago University sits an unusual clock.
The Beverly clock has been more or less running by itself for the last 160 years. Julian Lee investigates the magic contraption and the mystery of perpetual motion.
Hello. How are you?
Thank you, Sandra.
Thank you.
The University of Otago's physics department. As it just so happens, the worst possible time of day to do an interview. You see, at 3 p.m. every day, like clockwork, the scientists have afternoon tea.
Yeah, look at that, you see? They're very regular.
These physicists have been hiding in the stairwell waiting for us to finish. But now it's precisely 5 minutes past three. 5 minutes too long, and they can wait no longer.
Was it like that when you first came here as well?
Yes.
It's always been like that?
Always been like that. Time's very important for physics.
They walk past the Beverly clock.
The interesting thing about the Beverly clock is that, theoretically, it could run forever. It was built in, what does it say, 1864.
By Arthur Beverly?
By Arthur Beverly.
And why did he build it?
I think it was just a hobby of his. He was a jeweller and a watchmaker.
Since the beginning of time, we've been trying to figure out how to power things and move things with as little energy as possible. The wheel, horse, car, cars, trains, planes, fossil fuels, nuclear power, fusion, fission. But we've never achieved the ultimate, perpetual motion, free energy.
Is this the closest thing that we've got to perpetual motion?
It is, as far as we know, like, as far as we're concerned here, yes.
What would a world look like with perpetual motion?
the most magnificent form of science fiction you can imagine.
But it's not magic, it's just very clever.
Arthur Beverly recognised that he could get free energy from Earth's processes.
Inside this box, there's another metal box which is sealed and has oil about half full. And there's a little tube in the top of the box that has a float on it. And that float's attached to that rod at the back there. And as the temperature during the day rises and falls, so the volume of the air in the box rises and falls.
The air pressure changes, and that drives the oil up in the tank, and that pushes the device up to wind the crank. Arthur Beverly went away and he looked at the temperature. So you've got your thermometer, and he found he only needed to look at a temperature change of about 4 degrees Celsius, which is stuff all for New Zealand, right? Only the small temperature range would be enough for him to provide the extra energy needed to keep his clock going every day.
When did you inherit the caretaking duties?
About 15 years ago. When the technician who was looking at after it before me retired, he suggested that perhaps I would be interested in doing that. And I was.
Do you know what number caretaker you were? Is there a list?
No, there's no list. But since the 1940s, there's been three of us.
The clock's biggest enemy these days, modern air conditioning of all things, keeping indoor temperature at a constant, so now it needs tweaking. But as we now know, or think we know, time is relative, even when it comes to the physics department's 3 p.m. cuppa.
What time do they finish their coffee, or the tea? Is that also determined?
No, that's quite variable.